Hello, everyone. This is the quantum physics course, Phys 311, number 22. Last time, we had seen some solutions of Schrödinger equation as a function of displacement only, and we said that the time-dependent Schrödinger equation solution can easily be obtained if the x-dependent function, which is phi, is multiplied by some exponential function as a function of time. Okay, so this is what we had shown. Today we will solve the oscillations or just harmonic oscillator solutions. We will consider the HN. Now we have two particles instead of just one. So we assume that quantum mechanical particles are nucleus and the electron, for instance, and they have masses. Small m is electron mass and capital M is the mass of the nucleus. And we assume that these two somehow, electron and the nucleus, somehow oscillate, and also they move together. So if the translation takes place in X, so the whole hydrogen atom moves, okay, moves to some distance, but at the same time there is some oscillations inside. In order to separate the solution as a function of phi, as a function of r, now as you see, the time-independent solution is a function of two variables right now. We can show that this can be written as psi as a function of x and another function, okay, psi, okay, small psi as a function of r. So this is not the time-dependent wave function. It's just r-dependent. So what is this r though? Okay, let's check. Because we are dealing with two particle system, if we look at this two particle system from a reference frame, we can say that this is x1 or x1 vector and this is x2 vector. But if you just check, if you just take the difference between them, it's x1 minus x2, okay, this is, we assume that this is r vector. So basically the distance between the two is just the r vector. But now if we get the center of mass, if we get the center of mass of this system, which is probably here somewhere closer to the heavier particle, of course, so this is center of mass, then we can give a new variable to this and see how we can get the translation of the center of mass, and then the oscillations from the center of mass is considered to be, suppose that this is center of mass and we assume that there is a reduced mass, and this reduced mass oscillates back and forth as a function of r. Okay, so this reduced mass is m times m over m plus m. Okay, so this is how you can get the center of mass, right? The position of center of mass. So we will be dealing with center of mass instead of just one of these masses. So in this case, Hamiltonian as a function of r and x can be separated into two pieces, h as a function of x and h as a function of r. So the this is really beauty of this Hamiltonian, which shows that the two variable system can be separated into two different independent equations by using this property. But the time, the two variable dependent function, okay, can be also written as the product of these two. One is a function of totally x and the other is function of r only. In this case, If you write the Schrödinger equation, h r x r r is times psi or just phi x r is equal to e phi x r. So this is the Schrödinger equation. But now there are two variables. But now if you put this into here, we get h x plus h r. Okay. So this Hamiltonian is written as a summation of these two independent Hamiltonians, and then this phi is a function of r is written as just the product psi x and okay psi x and psi r is equal to e times again psi x times psi r. So now you can separate this into two pieces, and the first piece will give you h x, okay, psi x is equal to e x xi, okay, and then the other one h r psi small psi r is equal to e r. Now these are the eigenvalues of the solution, and these are the operators, and actually eigenvectors are xi in this case and psi in that case. E r okay psi r. So you can obtain this after opening this up and dividing both sides by these. You can get this form. So this equation gives you these kind of solutions, and the second one is the one we are dealing with. Okay, so this is the Schrödinger equation we are trying to solve. So let's write this Schrödinger equation in for the potential, which is harmonic oscillator. So the harmonic oscillator is 1 over 2 kx squared. K is the spring constant, as you see, you will remember. But instead of this, now we are dealing with r, so that the oscillations are made by the displacement now we are considering as r. So in this case, the potential that we will consider is just 1 over 2 k r squared. So now when we insert this potential here, actually here e minus v, right? So this is e, but e here is e total minus v. So this energy operator also should include the potential inside. So if you do this, then the Schrödinger equation can be written as minus h squared over 2 mu in this case, right? The only difference is this, okay, will be multiplied by d squared psi r over dx, dr squared now, okay, plus the potential k 1 over 2 kr squared minus er, okay, psi r is equal to zero. So we put this term to the left hand side and write again. Okay, so the potential now is included, and this energy is the eigenvalue is here. This is our object to find that this energy is discrete and quantized. This is the final result that we get. Okay, so this is just the differential equation. This is just a simple differential equation, but it needs some kind of rearrangement. After rearranging and leaving the second derivative alone, you can get d square psi r over dr square, okay, plus alpha minus beta square r square psi is equal to zero. So, and here alpha is a new definition. Alpha is 2 mu e divided by h bar square. As you see, if you look at here, dr, so we are just dropping this r subscript. We know that it's r, okay? So the product of this r, er by 2 nu and divided by h square is just the right hand side, okay? So this is just the coefficient of this where energy is placed. And here, beta is a quantity which is probably related to k. Yes, it's square root of nu k divided by h bar. So alpha and beta are just sub functions of energy and Planck constant and also the spring constant. And this spring constant, the k value of these oscillations is not easy to obtain, but we assume that somehow experimentally it is obtained. Okay, so let's turn over the pages and see the condition of this solution. We have to, this condition is very important. The first condition that you have to have in such solutions that psi r should be limited as r goes to infinity. Okay, so this is some limitation that we should never forget. Okay, so now let's find some asymptotic solutions. Some limits. Suppose that r goes to infinity. In this case, alpha is much smaller than beta square r square. Okay. So what does it mean? It means that if these two masses are too far away from each other, in this case, because this potential now, this because they are too far away from each other, okay, this term is greater than the other term because it is multiplied by r square. So this beta square r square is much greater than alpha, right? When r is so large, when they are far away from each other. Okay, so in this case, but still oscillating though. They are far away, but oscillating. Probably not so far away like that, but maybe just a little bit here. So this is like the maximum range of the oscillations, something like that. So r is not indeed going to infinity or something, but r is becoming large. So I don't think that this is a good definition. So I would like to change this definition to r is greater than one. Okay, so r is large, in other words, not infinity or something. So when r is large, then we can ignore this term, right? We can ignore this term in this equation. So this is the main equation we are solving. Okay, main differential equation or Schrödinger equation we are solving. Now, if this term is neglected, then this equation can be written as d square psi r over dr square, okay, minus or just equal to, because when you put this to the other side, it becomes positive, beta square r square psi r, right? So this is the equation we have now. Now, what kind of solution we will have? Remember that when there is no minus sign here, there is no oscillatory solution. It's just exponential increment or decrease. Okay, so the solution, the general solution of this can be n times some kind of coefficient e to the minus 1 over 2 beta r square. Okay, beta r square and plus n prime e to the plus 1 over 2 beta r square. So we have two different kind of solutions. One is exponentially decaying, the other is exponentially increasing. So these two solutions are possible. So, but now this is not physical because as r goes to infinity or just becomes very large, this term becomes very large. That's why this is not physical. So this boundness condition, where when r goes to infinity or r is very large, the function should be limited, states that this part shouldn't be a part of the solution. So the solution of this is that. So now, the reason that we have 1 over 2 is that when you take the second derivative, okay, second derivative, or it gives you 2 as the derivative of the exponent, okay? So these two should cancel. Anyway, so it's easy to show that this is the solution of this equation. So now let's check. let's check if it is correct, right? We can do that. But actually it does work. So let's skip that part. We know this solution, we have shown this earlier in previous examples. So now we do another change of variable. So let's write it down here. So the first one was alpha. We would remove this part. So I would like to have this sitting around e over h bar squared and beta given by square root of mu k divided by h bar. Now we have new definition, which is y. Y is just r times square root of b. So this part just gives us this idea that now if we do this, then we can write psi as a function of y now instead of r. But in this case, it will be equal to n times e to the minus y square over 2. Okay? Minus y square over 2. Okay? So in order to get this kind of solution, it's like exponential but Gaussian kind of distribution. Okay? It's the solution is not like very sharp decline, but it's soft decline. So this is r and r, right? So this is this kind of solution. The graph will look like that. That's okay. So we know that already. So we have all these definitions written here and the potential there, and the solution is this. Okay. So in this case, if this is the solution, okay, if this is a specific solution with this limit, but in general, we can offer that the solution of this generalized equation, which is this one. So let's say this equation number two, okay, number one is this. So in general, solution of equation two can be written as, okay, psi y is just some kind of constant and some kind of function of y e to the minus y squared over 2. Okay, so this term will give rise to a coefficient which is a function of y. So now we can put this into this expression and see if really it satisfies or not. Of course, by doing this, you can get some coefficients and so on. But now, when we have this equation here, let's get again the first derivative and the second derivative with respect to r and y. Don't forget, here we are assuming that y is equal to r squared of b. Okay? In this case, if we take d psi over dr, this is equal to d psi over dy times dy over dr, using the chain rule in the differentiation. So dy over dr is just square root of beta, as you see. If you take the derivative of this y as with respect to r, it's just square root of beta. So this is just square root of beta times d psi over dy. So if we just come across with some kind of first derivative with respect to r, then we can just get derivative with respect to y and just multiply by square root of beta. But what about the second derivative? We can do the same thing for the second derivative, taking derivative once more, and then we just readily see that it's just equal to beta or the square of square root of beta, d square psi over dy square. So in order to go from the second derivative with respect to r square to y square, all you need is just use this beta. Okay, here, right? So in this case, if psi is given by this, okay, then d psi over dy, okay, d psi over dy is just n times df over dy times e to the minus y square over 2 plus n times f, the derivative of this exponent, which is which is just the derivative of y squared is just 2y, but there is 2 on the denominator cancels, minus 2, right? So minus 2, the 2's will cancel and just minus y. So we will have just fy and there will be this minus sign, okay? Times, again, e to the minus y squared over 2, okay? So this is the derivative of the product, right? Because these two functions, the first, the derivative of the first times the second plus the derivative of the second times the first, where derivative of the second gives you a negative. Well, right. So we get this first derivative. What about the second derivative? If we get the second derivative, now we have to do the same thing for each term. Now, each one of these terms is now the product of two functions. So you have to get four terms out of this. So if you do this, then let's get the result. So n times d squared f over dy squared times e to the minus y squared over 2. Okay, minus, because the derivative of that will give you minus, n times df over dy times y, right? Derivative gives you y, times e to the. So everything will be multiplied by e to the. So this exponential terms, I'm just dropping and just multiply at the end. So minus n df over dy times y. Let's write it down here like that, so that it's more tidier. Now the derivative of f, we have now, since f is a function of y, and now we have triple thing. So we have to get the derivative of this, right? All these. So now the derivative of f, which is minus n df over dy y, okay? Now the derivative of y, which is just 1, so minus n f e to the something, okay? We just leave it outside the parentheses. Now the derivative of the last term, which will give us positive value, because this is negative and this is negative, and we will have n, actually n was the common, so it should have also been taken outside from the parentheses, but that's okay. We just kept it so far. So n times f times y squared, right? So y squared over 2 derivative is y, and there is another y, you get y squared. So times everything e to the minus y squared over 2. So now you can see that this derivative can be written as n times, okay, d squared f over dy squared, okay, minus 2y df over dy, because this term and this term are the same, you just add them up, okay, and then plus y squared f minus f times e to the minus y squared over 2, okay? So this is second derivative. So the second derivative, d squared psi over dy squared, is given by this expression. Okay, so this is second derivative that we will use. So now, so but here, let's now leave these equation. Don't forget this equation is still there. So let's just put this equation number 2 here also. Okay, d squared psi over dr squared plus alpha minus beta squared r squared. This is the main equation you're trying to solve, and it's equation number 2. Okay, so we need some space for that. Okay, so now what we are doing is that. Remember that the second derivative of with respect to r was this. So now we have beta times the second derivative. But the second derivative is given by this expression. So we are writing. So beta times d squared f over dy squared, okay, minus 2y df over dy plus y squared f minus f, okay, times e to the minus y square over 2. So this is only the first term we have written. Okay. Plus alpha minus beta square r square psi. But now psi is just, psi is given by just f times e to the minus y square. Don't forget, we have also n there, right? And n here. So n's will cancel, by the way. And the right-hand side is equal to zero. And so will be the exponents, okay? The exponents will be canceling. So that now, if you see that here, y square f, there is y square f here, and we will also have, okay, beta r square. Remember that here, if we just get this beta outside, so this term will give us beta times alpha minus beta r square. But beta r square is, remember that because of the definition, beta r square beta r square is just, let's check. Beta times r square is just y square. Because when you take square of this, y square equal to r square times beta, right? Because it's just square root of beta. So basically, this is nothing but just I square, y square. So if this is y square, then this term will cancel that term, right? So basically, this term is canceling that term due to the fact that this beta square r square is nothing but just y square. So now, after seeing this and rearranging this equation, we can get this. We can get an equation of just a function of f, d square f over dy square minus 2y df over dy, okay, plus alpha over beta. Remember that we took this beta outside, and we will have alpha over beta there, right? And minus 1 times f is equal to 0. Okay? So now if we take this alpha over beta minus 1 as 2n, some kind of quantum number, let's say, then this equation can be written as d square h over dy square minus 2y dh over dy, okay, plus 2n h y, of course, function of y only, is equal to 0. So instead of f, we are using h, so this is just a Hermit polynomial. Differential equation. So the solution of this kind of differential equation, in which we have second derivative, the first derivative, and also the constant term, where the coefficients are multiplied by 2 and this kind of form, these are called Hermit differential equations. And the solutions are Hermit polynomials for this. Okay? So basically, this is like Hermit solution, Hermit differential equation. So we put this also here. We said this is, because it's important. So now we put this change of the variables here. Alpha over beta minus 1 is equal to 2n. So we will just remember this later on. So this is the Hermit polynomial that we are trying to solve. And the solution of this is, the solutions are like that. The solutions as a function of y are minus 1 to the power of n. There are different modes of solutions, of course. E to the minus y square times d n over dyn, e to the minus y square, e to the minus y square. So depending on the mode number, you just get the derivative, okay? The first derivative, the second derivative, the third derivative. But we are lucky because the derivative of exponential is easy, right? So This is the Hermite polynomial solution. So the good thing is that this term goes to h goes to zero as y goes to infinity. But what is y? Y is related to the distance between the two objects, as you see. So let's write it here. It's written here, right? So this is good. So Hermite polynomials are bounded. Now we have this condition, which is important. So if this is correct, then we know exactly the solution. If we have the solution, then this is okay. Now, do you know what will happen? We will just write this again, because we know what alpha, beta are, because they were all given here. Remember that alpha is this, beta is that. Now, if you put all this, alpha over beta, 2 mu e over h bar squared divided by beta, which is given by square root of nu times square root of k divided by h bar, not square, okay, minus 1 is equal to 2m. So now, of course, in this case, it will be en, right? En, because alpha over beta is a function of n, so that these are different modes. So this is the value of en we are trying to find, okay? So now, one of these h bars get canceled, and now we have square root of mu over k, because mu over square root of mu gives you just square root of mu. So this gives us square root of mu over k, but this is equal to omega. So oscillation frequency. This is the oscillation frequency that you get in the harmonic oscillator. Or omega square is equal to mu over k. So this is regular harmonic oscillator solution. All right. So now we have two. Okay. So put this to the other side. So we have two omega square en divided by h bar, because one of the h got canceled. Put this to the other side and you will get 2n minus 1. Now, if you divide both sides by 2, you get omega square en over h bar, which is equal to just n minus 1 half. Okay. Is it minus or plus? Because when this minus sign, when it goes to the other side, it becomes plus. All right. So now, when you multiply everything by h bar over omega square, then you will get, we made a mistake, because this is omega to the minus 1. So k over mu is omega. So this is omega minus 2, right? So this omega minus 2. So it goes to the other side. En becomes equal to n plus 1 half, okay, times h bar times omega, just omega, right? But remember that h bar omega is equal to h nu, right? Without 2 pi, in this case, nu, the oscillation frequency of this harmonic oscillator is given by 1 over 2 pi square root of k over reduced mass. So this is the frequency that we have. So we can write this function as a frequency. En will be equal to n plus 1 half times h nu, okay? So these are the eigenvalues of harmonic oscillator. So it means that when the two objects oscillate quantum mechanically, then there are some different energy levels as a function of n, which happens to be Mod number, okay? So this is vibrational quantum number. That's why sometimes instead of n, we use nu, you know, this nu plus 1 half times h nu. This is, okay, capital nu, this is small. This is vibrational, or just let's use v as a letter, right? Vibrational quantum number. Here, v is vibrational quantum number. Now, when v is equal to zero, for right, so this is the first one, because here v runs from zero to higher and higher values, okay, infinitely many solutions we have, in other words. But for this minimum energy level, again, E0 is equal to just 1 over 2 H nu. So it means that this is zero point. So the quantum mechanics shows that harmonic oscillator has never zero energy. Actually, this is also supporting the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Why? Because remember that according to the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, the product of uncertainty in momentum and r is in the order of h bar or greater than, doesn't matter. But suppose that the energy of the harmonic oscillator is zero, then delta p should go to zero also, because E equals p square over 2m, right? If E goes to zero, p goes to zero. If p goes to zero, then delta p also goes to zero. In this case, according to this Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, delta r will go to infinity, right? But this is not possible. It's impossible. So quantum mechanically, this function should hold. In other words, although these are the uncertainty in momentum and the displacement, okay, none of them can go to infinity or none of them can go to zero, because these limits are very dangerous, right? So anyway, so we have now this. So the wave function, as a function of wave quantum number, then as a function of y, is given by n v, okay? So we can have different kind of coefficients, by the way, times h Hermite polynomial v as a function of y, and just the exponent e to the minus y square over 2. Okay, so this the normalization constant, which is to be found still. So we know that the normalization constant is this, from minus infinity to infinity, okay, psi star times psi, which is the probability density, by the way, square, dy is equal to 1, right? In this case, now, when you do this, you find n, right? Because this will give you just this product of n squared, and nothing is complex conjugate also is equal to itself, right? The function, because there is no complex stuff inside. So in this case, when you do this, you can show that it can be shown that this is not it's a tedious algebra. So beta over pi, square root of beta over pi, times 1 over 2 to the power of v times v factorial, okay, and everything square root. So this is the normalization coefficient. Okay, so normalization coefficient. So for instance, for v equals 0, we have Hermite polynomial, which is just 1. But when v equals 1, then the Hermite polynomial is just 2y. But when v equals 2, Hermite polynomial is 4y squared, okay, minus 2, and Hermite, this is 0, 1, 2, 3, is given as 8y cubed minus 12y. And these are the functions like that. So when we have v equals 0, suppose this is y, okay, and these are the energy levels, let's say, okay, when v equals 0, we have this kind of function, okay. because it will be solely just exponentially decaying function e to the minus y squared, which is centered about zero, right? This is y equals zero, by the way. So this coefficient is just one, and then we have just this exponential function. So this is v equals zero solution. In this case, the energy here, E zero, is given by just from this expression, 1/2 h nu zero, let's say. Nu zero is the frequency of this mode, okay, the lowest energy mode. When v equals zero, vibrational quantum number is one, then we have this kind of solution. So we should have zero here. It's like sinusoidal, right? Because when this is given by that, as you see, so you're multiplying this function or this function by some number times y, which is 2. When y is positive, this gives you exactly similar behavior, but when y is negative, it just turns the whole graph down to the negative axis, and then it behaves like that. So it's this. Now, if you have v equals 2, then the energy for this one, by the way, E1, is just 3/2 h nu 0. And then when v equals 2, then we have this kind of behavior. Let's say, show that this part is v, 0, y equals 0. And then we will have the minimum at this place. So in each one of these cases, as you see, the function, the wave functions, are going to zero at both ends. So this is just the boundedness condition that we have described earlier. So in this case, the energy will be given by, okay, the energy will be given by 5/2 h nu zero. So as you see, this goes on like that. So these are, so what does it mean? What does it mean? These solutions, remember that these are the solutions as a function of y, right? This kind of solution. So this is, here it shows that the center of mass, actually the reduced mass, is going up and down. Don't forget, this is the motion related to the reduced mass. Why? Because we have this, right? Mu here. We have reduced mass. And all the frequency and everything are defined as a function of reduced mass. Okay? So in this case, the reduced mass just goes up and down. So this kind of oscillation, right? So it's going up and down, around y equals zero. So the other one part is going up, the other part is going down. And then they are, of course, these are just the other parts, because you should think of this as also their counterparts, like this also, right? Because the oscillation is like that. Suppose there is a spring or just a rope connected by two ends. If you just hold the top or just leave it, it just oscillates like that. And similarly, if you have node in the middle, okay, then you have now increased the wavelength twice as much, right? And now this part oscillates up and down, but this part oscillates up and down like that. Okay? And then if you look at here, then again we have three parts. Okay? One part oscillates up and down, the other part oscillates up and down, and the other part oscillates exactly similar to the one on the right. Okay? So these kind of oscillations will take place between these two quantum mechanical particles. So we have this kind of solution. Okay, so this is the end of this example. Now let's go on to the potential well problem. Okay? So this is an interesting solution, Hermite polynomial. Please go ahead and check how the Hermite polynomial solutions are obtained and what are they. You can really check the internet to find out what kind of solutions they are, and you get some idea, some more idea about how to deal with this kind of differential equation. It's just the differential equation which has exact solutions. But this is called series solutions though. Okay, so different mode numbers. So now when we have potential well, actually the potential wells are not just like that, you know, they are not sharp. Usually this is not physical, but it just gives us some idea about the discreteness in the energy levels in this differential well. But the real differential well behaves like that, right? So it's like a parabolic function as a function of x. So now when you look at this parabolic solution, okay, suppose that this is just the energy level, okay, maybe like E6, right? Remember that in the previous harmonic oscillators, En or just EV was equal to V plus 1 over 2 H nu. And then when V equals 6, then E6 is equal to 6 plus, okay, 1 half H nu. H nu, which is now 13 over 2 H nu. So the energy. In this case, the oscillation, suppose that these are the turning points, x1 and x2. So we have this kind of solution. Okay, if this is x equals 0 in the middle, we have now, okay. So if this is the potential we have now, okay. So the solution will look like this. It will just touch here and then go to here, right? So the other side will be symmetric. Okay, so it will go all the way down and then go up and then come back to zero again. So this is now, so number of this six, V equals six is number of zero points. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or actually here, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The ones at the ends are not counted. Okay, 1 here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Number of zero is 6. So in this case, if we write this wave function, suppose that we have such a solution. In this case, wave function can be written as ax times sine fx. Okay, so if it's a function of x, right? And ax is a function of x, which is the magnitude. So this is the phase function of this wave function, right? In this case, if k is an integer, then delta f, since remember that this is the phase function, so the change in the phase f at the returning point, so these are the returning points, by the way, so don't forget the oscillations will take place like that, right? So always imagine this kind of oscillations up and down, right? But these are just the turning points. So now the difference of the phases here, right? X2 minus F1, the difference in the phases, in this case, is just 6. So this delta F is just E6, which is E6, but it's given by, okay, given by just 6 plus 1 half pi, right? For sixth excited state. Okay, in this case, delta F as a function of n will be approximately equal to n plus 1/2 pi. So the change in the phase at the turning points will be multiples of pi, where n runs from 0 to infinity. All right? In this case, what kind of, if the phase changes, is this value, then what is the value in energy change? Or what is the value of energy for this case? Okay. So if, remember that the previous solutions, remember in previous solutions, if V is constant, which was the easiest case, step potential and so on, where E total is greater than V, nothing was giving you a negative kinetic energy or something, the wave function was given by some kind of sinusoidal function, like sine x minus x zero, p over h bar. Okay? And a and x zero are constants. Okay? And here, p was just square root of 2m e minus v. Don't forget, v is constant. So the momentum was given by this expression. So this came from some kind of normalization. In this case, the function of x, if we just take the function of x here as, just forget the rest of the coefficients, just x minus x zero times p over h, this happens to be just the phase of this function. So phi x can be written as a p over h bar sine of f of x. So this is the phase, right? Good. So now in this case, in our case, phase is just x minus x zero times p over h. So this goes like that. Sorry about this. So if the new definition is now having this coefficient, which happens to be multiplying the momentum, okay? So this phase is just given by that. So now if this function, or if this wave goes at a distance x, suppose that this is sinusoidal function like that, and then it moves to right in x direction as delta x. In this case, df over dx will be equal to just, right, if you take the derivative of this with respect to x, what do you get? This is constant, zero, but it will be just giving you p over h bar. Okay? In this case, df, or the change in this, will be given by just p over h dx. And it should be equal to this delta f. But delta f was given by, so this was given by just square root of 2m e minus v divided by h bar dx. So this is definition in the momentum, right? So this is what you get. So now df then, if you just solve df will be equal to square root of 2m e minus v divided by h bar times dx. So this is just the phase we are dealing with now. We are really looking for the phase for the right running wave. The wave is moving right, don't forget. So we are dealing with the phases now. All right. Now let's see what's going on. So in this case, if this is the phase, then the total phase change is just between x1 and x2. These are the returning points in the harmonic oscillator. Okay, it will be df over dx times dx, right? This is just the change. Change in f. So this is approximately equal to 1 over h bar x1, x2 times square root of 2m e minus vx times dx. So these derivations are general derivations, by the way. So it's just df, right? So this is also just df, and df is given here. So there is nothing magical about this expression. So remember that delta f was just approximately equal to n plus 1/2 times pi. Okay, these are the points at which the sinusoidal function became zero. In this case, we now define a new variable, which is just g, which is just this equation without h bar. Okay, without h bar, this will give you just x1 to x2 square root of 2m e minus vx. So this is some kind of new function that we define, and this should be e approximately equal to n plus 1/2 pi. Okay, 1/2 pi. We can really find energy from this expression. Okay, in this case, we see that g is just approximately equal to n plus 1/2 pi. So this is a new definition. So the integration, so this integral is just nothing but equal to g, and it is equal to n plus 1/2 pi. Don't forget, n is running from 0 to infinity. This is WKB method. Okay, so according to this WKB method, then we can find out how this energy is discretized, and also this function, which is just the integration between the turning points. Okay, don't forget 2m e minus v is related to just the momentum, right? So this is just the energy, then, related to energy, because energy is related to the momentum. Okay, so this is now the solution. All right, so let's see the molecule. Let's continue to the molecular case and see the molecular vibrations. Continue with the molecular vibrations. Okay, don't forget the molecules have 3 degrees of freedom. Atoms, just one single atom, just move and there is a displacement of x. But for molecules, there are 3 things. One, this molecule can move in x, and also these molecule pieces can oscillate back and forth. Okay, this is oscillations, and this is vibrational oscillations. And also this is translation, and also there is one more, which is rotation. So these particles, just as they are moving, the constituents of these molecules, like carbon dioxide, for instance, 2 oxygen and 1 carbon, they just rotate around. Okay, so this is rotation. So basically 3 degrees of freedom in molecules. So each one of these rotations, vibration and translation are discretized. Okay, discretized. And there are uncertainty principles also applied to these molecules. So dealing with molecules more difficult because you have more than one particles, which we have done. Remember that we considered the reduced mass, which was m times m over m plus m. So this was the reduced mass due to two masses, which complicated our problem a little bit. But by going to the center of mass, position of the center of mass, we were able to deal with it easily. So now, now let's the excitation of molecular vibrations and rotation. So excitation of vibrations and rotations. So now let's assume that the turning points are x1 is equal to minus x0 and x2 is equal to just x0. So we have this kind of potential, something like that, and then we have, these are approximate solutions, by the way. So this is just minus x0, this is just x0, right? So we have this kind of bound states like that, and now we have the potential. Potential is, as you see, the potential is like a parabola. So V as a function of x is given by 1 over 2 kx squared, k being the vibrational spring constant, and omega 0, the vibrational frequency, is just square root of k over m, or just mu, let's say. Okay? So now, as you see at the turning points, we have just energy here. So energy is just passing from here, and then these are the turning points, right? So in this case, if the energy is given by just this value passing from this intersection cases, then V x1, so this is x1 and this is x2, by the way. Is it true? That's right. This is x1 and x2. V x1 is equal to V x2, and this is equal to total energy, because our energy is just defining the turning points. So from here, we can say that the total energy is just 1 over 2 k x0 squared, because this x1 and x2 value is x0, and x0 being square root of 2e over k being the spring constant. In this case, this, remember the integral ge is just x1 to x2 dx square root of momentum, which is 2m e minus vx. Okay, times dx, of course. So we will integrate. Now, the limits, so ge, this function, I will just write the previous results that we have obtained. Okay. The previous result that we have obtained was that ge was equal to approximately n plus 1 half pi. This is what we have obtained. Okay, so now in this case, ge is equal to just from minus x0 to x0 dx, okay, just square root of km or k mu times x0 square minus x square. Okay? Don't forget, we obtained E at E as 1 over 2 k x0 square. Here, we inserted for E. So this is 1 over 2 k x0 square, but Vx is 1 over 2 k square. So, and over 2 is factored out and 2 got cancelled. And this is just the expression we have. And this is being mu. So now, we can now say that x equals x0 times sine theta, right? In this case, if x is equal to x0 sine theta, then x0 squared minus x squared is given by x0 squared, okay, 1 minus sine squared theta. But 1 minus sine squared theta is just cosine squared theta, right? So in this case, we have now this g, which is equal to, from minus infinity to infinity, square root of k mu is taken outside, okay, times, right, times, now square root x0 minus x squared, which is just x0 squared, 1 minus sine squared theta, which is cosine squared theta, right? X0 squared times cosine squared theta. So instead of this, we have now just the product of x0 squared and cosine squared theta. Times dx, of course. We have to somehow go from x to theta, by the way. So in this case, we can, since the integration is written as a function of theta, we have to also write this dx as a function of d theta, right? And how do you do this? Because we are given by this, from here, dx is equal to x0 times cosine theta d theta. So now we have, instead of dx here, we have to have the product, which is x0 times cosine theta d theta. So this square root turned out to be an easy integration, okay? So we have now x0 here, because the square root of x0 is x0, and another x0 is x0 squared, so that ge will be equal to x0 squared times square root of k mu times, okay, cosine square theta d theta. From 0 to pi over 2, right? Because what happens? When x is minus infinity, okay, but x cannot be infinity because it's limited from probably x, x0, minus x0, then we have sinusoidal 0. But when here, when we have x0, then it is equal to zero also. It's like sine function like that, right? Being zero at both ends. In this case, we have the integration limits being from zero to pi hat. All right. So now, can we write solve this integration? Yes, because it's just x zero squared. And by the way, is there any factor of two we are missing? Two mu. Let's see. Right. There is square root of 2. Let's check. One minus square root. Okay, these two over there. We have square root of 2 got cancelled, and we have nothing, just this value. That's right. Okay, so let's continue then. It's just now x0 squared times this square root. Okay, then let's just write the constants, k mu, now integral. Cosine squared theta is just 1 plus cosine 2 theta over 2, right? Times d theta, limits again from 0 to pi hat. So the first equation gives you just 1 half, and now pi over 2. So x0 squared square root of k mu, okay, times pi hat. Pi over 4. Okay, pi over 4. And there should be a factor of 2, right? Let's check where it's coming. Right, here we are. 2kn. 2 and E. Okay, 2 E. Okay, I'm just trying to check where this 2 is coming from. Right. So remember that actually we made a mistake because it's not a mistake, but we just missed one thing. So this condition was going to be these limits was from minus pi half to what pi half, right? Because cosine is zero, cosine is zero at minus pi half and at pi half. So but now since this is an even function, we said that we can write this from zero to pi half and multiply by two. That's it. So two should be there. So this is a factor of two that is coming from changing the limits. So minus pi half here and pi half there, but instead of this, we use zero to pi half. So that's right. So this is the first term that we have obtained. What about the second term? The second term is equal to zero. Because sine gives you, let's check. Okay, so the integral plus 2x0 squared square root of k mu. Now we have 1 over 2, so we have 1 over 2 there, integral from 0 to pi half cosine 2 theta d theta. But the integral of cosine 2 theta is just 1 over 2 sine 2 theta, okay, with a minus sign. Now when you put the limits from 0 to pi over 2, okay, you will get 0. So this term will just vanish. In this case, g will be given by, just these two will cancel 4, and then it will be given by just, okay, square root of x0 squared times square root of k mu times pi. Okay, so now remember that the definition of x0 was, definition of x0 was just square root of 2e over k. So now we can write this as x0, which is 2e over k square root of k mu pi. But now this k gives you square root of k on the denominator, so that g or just this integration that we have defined is nothing but equal to just pi e times square root of mu over k. So this should be equal to just n plus 1/2 pi h bar, right? But now, since this is inverse of omega, we can write now, or let's say omega zero or something. So these pi's get canceled, and then En will be given by just approximately equal to omega zero times n plus 1/2 h bar. So as you see, to get the energy, this is WKD approximation. All you need to do is to solve this equation. Okay? We forgot dx though here. Okay, so we solve this equation, but in order to solve this equation, it's better to use a change of variable, which gives us a better analysis of this sinusoidal and cosine sinusoidal functions. And then the solution is easily obtained. So as you see, for the vibrations of the molecules, we are obtaining exactly the same result that we have obtained earlier. So this really concludes today's lecture, guys. So I hope that it was good explanations, and I try to give you just the molecular vibrations. Of course, after this step, there are more theory included, but not at this level. See you later.